Hello, I'm Justin Brierley. It's Saturday afternoon. It's Premier Christian Radio. That can only mean one thing: unbelievable. Bringing you the best in dialogue between believers and non-believers. Helping you to think through your faith if you're a Christian. Helping you to think through your assumptions and worldview if you're of another faith or no faith at all.
You're unbelievable.
Well, today on the programme, the subject under discussion and the two guests who find each other a little bit unbelievable are Bart Ehrman and Simon Gathercole. We're asking today, did the early Christians turn a human preacher from Galilee into the Son of God? That's the subject of Bart Ehrman's latest book. The claim at the heart of the Christian faith is that Jesus of Nazareth was and is God. But in his new book, How Jesus Became God, New Testament historian Bart Ehrman says that's not what the original disciples believed about him, and not even what Jesus believed about himself. Well, a response book, How God Became Jesus, written by a number of evangelical Bible scholars, is being released at the same time. And one of their authors, Simon Gathercole, who's a New Testament scholar in Cambridge, joins me to debate with Bart on today's programme. So I've been really excited to have you both in the studio with me, gentlemen. Thank you very much for coming in. Bart, I think this must be the fourth or fifth time you've joined me on the programme.
At least.
Yeah, so you're becoming a bit of a regular now.
Yes.
It's a happy coincidence that you have family here in the UK, so occasionally your diary allows you to come and join me here in the studio in London and talk about your latest project.
So, yes, well, thanks for having me.
Thanks for coming back.
Yeah.
And Simon, new to the show, but perhaps not a stranger for too long, because we're going to do two of these shows, and we're going to be hearing you both for the next week and the following one as well. Perhaps there was the newcomer. Would you like to tell us a little bit about yourself and your background and how you got into biblical studies?
Sure. I didn't come from a Christian family particularly, although a family based on Christian values, but without really going to church. And I became a Christian in my teens. And at the time, I was very interested in Latin and Greek and ancient history. I went to very traditional schools, mm-hmm. where you start Latin and Greek very young. And so I went on to study classics in Cambridge. And after doing that, I got more and more interested in wanting to study the Bible in the original languages, and so moved over to theology and to a PhD in
Fantastic.
New Testament studies.
Okay, and is there a sort of particular area that you'd say is your sort of, you know, your thing, your baby?
I don't know, a bit of everything.
Yeah,
my PhD was on Paul, but since then I've moved more into Gospels and apocryphal Gospels.
Sure. Okay. Well. Be interested to hear what you make of today's discussion and what you've said in this new book, which is a response to Bart. But let's come to you, Bart. You're the James A. Gray Distinguished Professor of Religious Studies, long title, at the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill. But people know you very well for some of your popular books, as much as your academic books. Misquoting Jesus was the first one you came in to talk about, obviously. And I think people know you for your story as well, which you've often shared on the programme. You were a evangelical, Bible-believing, in quotes, Christian, but it was really your biblical studies that led you to question your beliefs about Scripture in the end.
That's right. I, like Simon, I became a Christian, a born-again Christian at least, in high school when I was a teenager, and had gone to a fundamentalist Bible college, Moody Bible Institute in Chicago. And I had thought at that point in my young life that the Bible was inerrant without any mistakes in it and was the absolute God-given guide for what to believe and practice. And it was over the years of scholarship that I started changing that view. I began to realize there are, in fact, discrepancies in the Bible. Different authors have different views of every important topic, including who God is and who Christ is. And so I moved away from my evangelical commitments to be what I would have considered to be a fairly liberal Christian. For many years, the reason some people know I became an agnostic eventually, but the reason wasn't related to my scholarship.
That was more an issue around how you could reconcile God and evil and so on.
Yes, something else we've talked about on the program.
Yeah, and in that sense, you know, I think a lot of people listening will already be familiar to some extent with your story and your previous work. Now, my suspicion is that this new book, How Jesus Became God, is sort of, if you like, somewhere along the lines of what you did with misquoting Jesus, in that you're taking a sort of another evangelical kind of view that's strongly held and defended in many ways, and you're again being the thorn in the side, and doing it in a way which is, I think, probably going to reach a popular audience again in the way that misquoting Jesus did. So do you want to give us a little bit of the background to to where this book's coming from?
Yeah, you know, I didn't write either book. This may come as a surprise to some of your listeners. I didn't write either book actually to be a thorn in anybody's side. I'm interested in the history of early Christianity, the history of how the Bible came down to us, the history of who Jesus was, and I'm interested in writing about that from a historical perspective. This particular book is dealing with what I think is arguably the most important question, not just in Christianity, but in, you could argue it's the most important question in the history of Western civilization.
Yeah.
Because if Jesus had not been considered to be God, his followers would have remained Jews within, they would have been of Jewish sect within Judaism. Gentiles, by and large, would not have converted to Christianity. The Roman Empire would not have converted to Christianity. The Emperor Constantine would not have converted to Christianity. And the entire history of Western civilization would have been different as a result. So I think it's really important to figure out how did it happen.
Yes, but so I think, I'm sure every scholar likes to think their work will shake the very foundations of Western civilization. But in a sense, if you're right in this, it would be a game changer.
Well, it would, but the question, whether I'm right or wrong, the question itself, I would insist, is still one of the most important questions in history of civilization. So, I mean, if Jesus did teach that he was God and his disciples believed that while he was alive, that would be hugely momentous. If he didn't, that would also be hugely momentous. And so so I think it's a key question no matter how one comes out on it.
I think we probably agree on that.
Yes,
yeah,
I think so.
Perhaps we will have some measure of agreement then today. But tell us about this response book then, which, you know, imaginatively is How God Became Jesus. Because it's unusual, actually, I think, to see a book and its response book coming out at the same time. And I think this has required a little bit of negotiation, I assume, between the publishers and so on to allow the writers, that includes you, Simon, of the response book to see the manuscript early and so on. So do you want to tell us about came from, Simon?
It's very kind of Bart to allow such a thing
to
happen.
It's sporting, I'd say.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, obviously it's, there's a measure of good publicity on both sides, and there's no such thing as bad publicity. I know Bart loves a good argument and a debate, so that's part of the aim of both books. Michael Bird from Australia was I think the sort of driving force in the project, and he's one of the major contributors to the book, and I think it partly could come about because Bart's book is published by. Is it Harper Collins or Harper San Francisco?
Harper One.
They've changed their name. It's Harper One.
Harper One, right? Yeah. Okay, yeah. And Harper is this enormous great empire which includes the evangelical publisher Zondervan, and so Zondervan were able to cooperate with Harper One in order to produce this response.
Because they're part of the big family, as it were. Okay, yeah. Got you. And when did you get wind yourself of Bart's book and start to sort of plan a response?
I only first heard about it in November. And didn't look at the manuscript actually until January. So I think Mike Bird and others had seen it before. So we produced our response very, very quickly.
Yes, indeed.
We were really under the cosh, but it was good fun to do.
I like this because it really is an exclusive then for Unbelievable. These books are both hot off the press as we speak, and you can of course find links to both of the books from the Unbelievable webpage as ever, premier.org.uk/unbelievable. I'm really pleased we've got, you know, both two key people, as it were, in for this discussion, both this week and next, on this theological question. If you want to respond to anything you hear on today's programme, and I know these are going to be popular, especially around the world with all those bibliophiles who tune into these kinds of shows, do get in touch. Be interested to hear from you. unbelievable@premier.org.uk. You can also, of course, follow on Twitter, give me a comment that way, do it via the Facebook page, facebook.com/unbelievablejb or at unbelievablejb for the Twitter handle. All those links and more and past programmes, and I'll definitely post up a few links to previous shows that Bart has contributed to, all available from the webpage, premier.org.uk/unbelievable.
Unbelievable with Justin Brierley.
So the subject under discussion today, how Jesus became God. Well, that's the title of Bart Ehrman's latest book. We're asking, did the early Christians turn a human preacher from Galilee into the divine Son of God? We're going to be hearing both from Bart and Simon Gathercole, who join me in the studio today. I think one of the first sort of things to outline is how we distinguish between a faith belief, if you like, in the doctrine of Christ's divinity and the historical question that we're actually tackling here. I don't know if you want to talk about that a little bit, Bart, because is it one thing to believe Christ is divine and another thing, if you like, to ask, well, when did people start believing that, if you like?
I do think there's a difference, and it's a difference that a lot of people have trouble getting their minds around, because people think that if something is true, then it's true, whether it's historically true, theologically true, it's all true, and so truth is one thing, not two different things. But one of the things I try to emphasize with my students and in my writing is that there are ways of doing history and there are ways of doing theology, and those are two different things. A clearer example for a lot of people is something like the resurrection of Jesus. Christians, of course, believe that Jesus was raised from the dead. Most Christians believe he was physically raised from the dead. And so the question is that a theological belief, or is that something that you can establish historically? Mm-hmm. If you can establish it historically, that means that historians can look at evidence and establish that this is probably what happened. But even if you can't establish it historically, people could still believe it.
Sure.
And so a theological truth isn't necessarily the same as the historical truth. And in this book, what I'm trying to do is not question whether Jesus is God. I actually leave open the question of whether Jesus is God, and I don't try to prove that he wasn't God.
Okay.
I'm simply interested in the historical question. When is it that people began to say that he was God? Was it during his lifetime, or was it afterwards? And if it was afterwards, what made them say that?
But will the question, the historical question, have an impact on our theology, Simon, I wonder? Because if Bart's hypothesis is true, and we'll give him a chance to spell it out in a moment, that it was a later development than is often, you know, painted, the belief in Jesus's deity, is that going to be a significant problem for Christians and their belief in the deity of Jesus?
I partly agree with Bart that the theological and historical questions are, at least in some cases, distinct. So the resurrection is a very good example. I mean, I guess many Christians would not think you could historically prove beyond reasonable doubt that Jesus was raised from the dead, even though one may think there are sort of historical indicators, both in terms of the consequences and other factors as well. But I suppose for many Christians, there are two factors which mean that the distinction between history and theology sometimes gets rather muddied. The first, I suppose, is that unlike in some religions where the religion is not based on any sort of historical events and is more about a more matter of timeless truths, Christians by and large have historically believed that God acts in history,
mm-hmm.
and so there is not a kind of gap between the material, this worldly,
yes,
realm of history and what sort of God may do up there, apart from it all. You know, all the way through the Old Testament and the New Testament, one sees testimony to God acting in history, and that's a fairly fundamental belief for many Christians. The other factor, I suppose, is that for most Christians down the ages, it's the apostolic and related testimony to these actions, taking the New Testament as our case today, the testimony to those actions is enshrined in Scripture in the New Testament, and so because Christians have historically rooted Christian doctrine in Scripture, if one were to say that, well, such and such a doctrine is an interesting doctrine, but emerged in the 8th century AD, centuries after Scripture, and has no foundation in the New Testament, then that's what leads Christians to question it. So historically, there's been a distinction made between the normative status of Scripture, which has the capacity for Christians to shape doctrine, and other sort of important ideas enshrined in the creeds, for example, which are have a degree of authority but don't have the ultimate status that Scripture has.
Sure.
And so many Christians accept the creeds but wouldn't necessarily regard them as divinely inspired in the way that they would the New Testament.
Yes, and I mean, I wanted to ask about, for instance, the Nicene Creed. Now, you'll have to give me dates on this, but it was about sort of 300 years after the events, really, that a definitive statement on the nature of the Trinity and so on came into being. Now, for you, Bart, is that a sort of an example of, well, the Church finally decided what they believed about Jesus and the Holy Spirit and God about 300 years after the actual events?
Right. So I deal with this in my book about how we got the Nicene Creed.
Mm.
And what we call the Nicene Creed today, so what people confess in church today is the Nicene Creed, is a bit of an edited version of what came out of the Council of Nicaea in the year 325. And it was a key moment within the life of Christianity, because the bishops, who were the church leaders who were at the Council of Nicaea, were debating, in what sense is Jesus God? Everybody agreed that he was God, but was Christ a divine being who had been created by God in eternity past and had then himself created the universe? Mm-hmm. So that he was subordinate to God and was a second level divinity, or had Christ always existed and he was always completely equal with God and of the same essence as God? That's what was debated at the Council of Nicaea. And the Nicene Creed is the creed that came out of that, in which it affirmed the second option, that Christ was always eternal, always with God. And one of the points I try to advance in my book is that this formulation is a later formulation. It's something that happened hundreds of years later. The apostles were not debating these issues about what kind of God is Jesus.
Mm.
So
mm.
I think everybody has to agree there was development, so that the views of Christology that people have today, the views of Christ that people have today, are rooted in later developments. And the question is, when do those developments begin?
Yeah. So how do you parse out this issue of this idea that there is sort of some, in some sense, theological progression, where you're getting down to, as it were, the fine tacks of how you view Jesus and God and the Holy Spirit and so on with the Nicene Creed, and is it just kind of completely removed from Scripture, or is it kind of a natural outworking in some way of what began in the pages of Scripture for you, Simon?
Yeah, I mean, I would see it much more as a natural outworking, and I suppose the discussions in the early church about Christology emerge from the fact that within the New Testament you have different expressions, of course, of who Jesus is. But one of the running tensions that you have in different places in the New Testament is that Jesus looks, on the one hand, very like God, but on the other hand, seems distinct from God the Father. So for example, in John's Gospel, you have the statement, I, the Father is greater than I, but also I and the Father are one. And so within the New Testament itself, you've got that tension, which is not resolved. It's not resolved by any of the New Testament authors, as I totally agree with Bart that the apostles didn't really sort of discuss these things. There's no attempt in the pages of the New Testament to sort of systematize these things, to provide sort of nice rounded philosophical responses to how these two truths might fit together. And again, one finds the same thing in Paul, where Jesus receives, every knee will bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. This looks like the worship that God Almighty receives in the Old Testament, and yet that worship that Jesus receives is to the glory of God the Father.
Yes, sure.
Same in Revelation. And so throughout the New Testament, one finds this tension that none of the New Testament authors really seeks to resolve. But
for you, the seeds are there, if you like.
Yeah, absolutely. And what happens in the later centuries are attempts to resolve those tensions.
And to sort of codify them to some extent.
Yeah, can I just say that I completely agree with that. The seeds are absolutely there in the New Testament. The problem is that these seeds grow in different ways in different parts of the church, so that the people who are opposed at the Council of Nicaea also are quoting Scripture and also see their views as coming out of Scripture, but their views come to be declared as heresies. And that happened in the 2nd century, in the 3rd century, in the 4th century, and it continued on. So it's not that what we think of as Orthodox Christianity is the natural growth from these seeds. It's one of the growths from these seeds. And the question is, why did this growth end up becoming the orthodoxy that it became instead of some other growth?
I mean, do you want to respond to that, Simon, in as much as I'm presuming you believe the Nicene Creed in that sense, that you're not a modalist or a whatever those other heresies were competing.
I would certainly agree that at times in the church that in patristic history there was rather slightly too much over precision in defining what is in and what is out. But essentially, I do think that the Nicene Creed is not just one of the possible ways in which one might resolve the New Testament tensions that we've talked about. But I do think it's the natural one.
Well, let's before we have to start concluding this section of the program, just get you to lay out your case briefly from the book, Bart. What's your view then about what the first Christians thought about Jesus, and then we'll let Simon respond.
Right. So, this will take me 2 hours. I hope that's okay.
You've got 5 minutes.
You're filibustering your way through the program.
I'll give it in a nutshell with the proviso that it doesn't sound nearly as good in the nutshell as it does.
You still have to go and buy the book.
My view is that the historical Jesus himself did not go around talking about himself as God. Mm-hmm. It's striking that that Jesus does indicate such things in the Gospel of John, as we've just heard, as Simon said. But you don't have Jesus making these kinds of claims, I and the Father are one, before Abraham was, I am, those sorts of things in Matthew, Mark, or Luke, or in the sources of Matthew, Mark, and Luke. So if people believe in the Q source or the M, the L, none of these early sources mention this about Jesus. And it seems very strange indeed that if Jesus was going around calling himself God, that our earliest sources don't say anything about it. I mean, how could that be? I mean, this would be the most important thing of his entire ministry. So it seems unlikely they just forgot to mention that part. Mm-hmm. So it seems more likely that what's happening is that when you get to the Gospel of John, you have Christians who believe firmly that Jesus is God, and so they put these words on his
list. It's generally accepted that John is, as it were, the latest in that sense. And so your view would be that there's a chance for development effectively,
right.
Between the synoptics and John.
That's right. So my view is that Jesus didn't teach this about himself, and that his earliest disciples didn't believe this about him when they were with him during his public ministry. And yet, we do have very early evidence that after his death, this is what Christians were saying about Jesus, that he was God. Mm. And so if it's not what he was saying about himself, and it's not what his disciples were saying about him, how did they come to this belief? And what I try to show in my book is that the key moment was the belief in Jesus' resurrection.
Okay.
The disciples came to think that Jesus was raised from the dead. And I have an extended argument about what it is that made them think that. And I lay out the argument in a way that I think Christians could agree with.
Okay.
Maybe not fundamentalist Christians, but the New Testament is consistent that the thing that made Jesus' followers believe he was raised from the dead was that they had visions of him. Uh-huh. He appeared to them. And you could agree to that whether you're a Christian or not, because Christians would say, yes, Jesus appeared to them. Non-Christians would say, well, they're having hallucinations.
They believed that Jesus appeared to them. Yes.
So at that moment, I think what happened is the disciples thought that God had raised Jesus from the dead, and wasn't that his body came back to life and he's still here with us. He's not here with us. He's not here. Where is he? He's in heaven. And so when ancient people, whether Greeks or Romans or Jews or any ancient people thought that God had taken somebody up to heaven, they thought that meant the person had been made divine. And so the disciples naturally thought that Jesus has been made divine. So at the moment they came to believe in the resurrection of Jesus, they came to believe in the divinity
okay.
of Jesus.
All right. Well, that was very much nutshell, and we'll crack the nut open a bit in the next next section of the program. Simon responds, but Bart mentioning their issues around the resurrection as well. So many directions we could go in, but I would recommend listening to back to some of the programs he's been on before, where we've tackled issues around the resurrection. Mike Lacona, I remember you had a good old debate with him on that in the past. So do check back on the Unbelievable page for links to those as well. But today we're talking about how Jesus became God, or how God became Jesus. Did the early Christians really turn a human preacher from Galilee into the Son of God? That's the claim in Bart Ehrman's latest book. And with him in studio today to discuss this, Simon Gathercole, New Testament historian from Cambridge. So keep listening. We'll be back in a moment's time as we open this up for discussion.
You're listening to Unbelievable on Premier Christian Radio.
Our topic today, though, is this whole question of what we make of the early Christians' beliefs about Jesus. Did they evolve over time? Or were Christians believing that Jesus was the Son of God divine from day one, if you like? What do the Gospels have to say? And that's particularly our focus in this section of the programme. And next week, we'll get a chance to turn to what St. Paul had to say and the other bits of the Bible as well. Simon, Bart gave a very brief kind of description of what's in the book. You had a chance to read it and respond to it, obviously. Your chapter in particular in the response book, How God Became Jesus, deals with what the early Christians thought mm-hmm. about Jesus. So do you want to sort of start us off with your general response to the way Bart sort of lays his case out, and then we'll open things up?
Sure. My chapter in the book is focused really on the exaltation, which is, I suppose, not so much concerned with where Bart started just now, and very properly on the question of the historical Jesus. I suppose one thing I'd make in comment in response to what Bart said about the historical Jesus is that I don't see quite such a disjunction between the synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and John, as Bart does. And Bart put it that the Gospel of John has Jesus going around saying he's God,
saying things which surely would have been picked up in the other ones.
Yes, yeah, so, I mean, I don't actually think that Jesus does go around in John's Gospel saying that he's God. I mean, he makes these very striking statements, and mm-hmm. you know, which are rather confusing. And but of course, it's actually in the framing of John's Gospel that the Gospel writer uses to put the Gospel together, where it's really explicitly said that Jesus is God. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And so there's actually a distinction in John's Gospel between what Jesus says to some extent
and what the Gospel writer says about
Jesus. Yes, again, you know, Jesus never goes around saying that the world was made through him, but the Gospel writer in the prologue does say, through him all things were made, without him was there anything made that was made. And so I don't think that one needs to have such a sharp distinction between what John says and what the synoptic say, because again, in the synoptic Gospels, there are extraordinary things that are.
I mean, give us a few examples of what you would say are as extraordinary as what John has Jesus say in.
Well, I suppose just as Jesus' teaching in John's Gospel might well imply a claim to divinity, so also in the synoptic Gospels, just to take two examples, two very brief examples. In the Synoptic Gospels, Jesus claims that he has the power to choose who is saved and who isn't. Mm-hmm. So no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and those to whom the Son chooses to reveal him many people will call a Q saying, because it appears in Matthew's Gospel and Luke's Gospel. So the sort of power of election, you know, the power of choosing who is saved and isn't, very much as sort of divine prerogative against its Old Testament background. Or again, the claim that Jesus has the authority to forgive sins. Again, this is something which, again and again in the Old Testament, is not something which you can just, one chap can do to another. This is a claim.
So you'll find this, for instance, in the story, I think in Mark, is it, where the paralytic is lowered, you know, and Jesus says...
That's right, in Mark chapter 2, and it's parallels in Matthew and Luke, where... Jesus comes this paralyzed man is lowered through the roof, and everyone wants him to everyone wants Jesus to heal him, but Jesus in fact says, "My child, your sins are forgiven," and later heals him in order to demonstrate that the Son of Man actually does have authority to forgive sins.
And the commentary at that point from the sort of dubious religious leaders is, well, who has authority to forgive sins but God?
Yes.
And for you, that's a kind of affirmation that the point you're taking away is, well, Jesus was saying, yep, you got it right, guys, kind of thing.
Yeah, again, it's implied. It's not Jesus going around saying he's God, but it is a very strong claim, a very strong implicit claim, both one which is reinforced by Jesus in his healing miracle and also in the response by the
I'm sure Bart's bursting to respond on these issues. What do you make of this?
Well, I've got a couple things to say. One is that I don't think that Jesus' claim in Mark 2 is to be God. If he was claiming to be God in Mark 2 when he forgave sins, they would have taken up stones to stone him for blasphemy.
But that is mentioned a couple of times elsewhere, isn't it?
In the Gospel of John.
He is accused of blasphemy, though, isn't he?
He's never... You mean at the trial?
In Mark 2.
Well, he said his response... His
fellow is blaspheming, no one can forgive sins.
Yes, they say that. No one can forgive sins except... And Jesus' response is not, you're right, only God can forgive sins, that's why I forgave sins. His response is, no, in order to show you that even the Son of Man has power to forgive sins, and he forgave the sins. So we could get into a long argument about the interpretation of Mark 2, but that's actually not one of my 2 points.
You've got a different 2 points.
So one point is, I agree that in the Synoptic Gospels, Jesus is understood to be divine. Absolutely. Yeah, they understand him to be God. But they don't think that Jesus is a pre-existent divine being. This is where Simon and I are really going to disagree. They don't understand Jesus in the way the Gospel of John does. It's wrong. I think it's wrong to say that Jesus does not claim to be God in the Gospel of John. Yes, he does. John 8:58, before Abraham was, I am. Jesus is declaring for himself the name of God from Exodus chapter 3, I am. Mm-hmm. And the Jews know perfectly well what he's saying. They take up stones to stone him to death. Chapter 14, verse 9, whoever has seen me has seen the Father. Mm. John chapter 17, verse 5, Father, glorify me with the glory that I had with you before the world was created. Mm-hmm. Jesus is claiming to be a pre-existent divine being who himself is God. I and the Father are one. So it's true that in the prologue to John, he's identified as God, but throughout this gospel, he's making claims about himself, that he himself is God.
And so the difference is that in John, we've moved to a position where we've got the pre-existence of God, Jesus, as part of the Godhead in some sense.
Well, that's part of it, but it's also he's claiming equality with God. He's not simply claiming to have authority that the Father has given him.
Yeah.
He's saying that, in fact, he himself is a divine being. And the reason this matters is because if you don't find these self-claims in the Synoptics, then it's unlikely that the historical Jesus actually said them. And my point is, this idea of Jesus as God does not go back to Jesus' own lifetime.
Yeah, response then on that.
Sorry. Again, I think there's slight exaggerations on both sides in that in John's gospel, Jesus does say that the authority has been given to him by the Father, everything is committed to him by, you know, just as Matthew and Luke say, all things have been committed to me by my Father. So Jesus says in John's gospel, the Father has granted him to have life in himself, and that the Father has given him all things. So this is the tension, isn't it? That there's equality on one level, I and the Father are one, but also Jesus says the Father is greater than I, and so there's that tension how do you sort out I see a similar tension in the Synoptic Gospels.
Yeah. What do you do with Bart's view, though, that if Jesus did say those things historically that are recorded in John, they would have shown up in the Synoptics, but they don't? I mean, do you just think that it's just the writer of John had access to stuff that the writers of those Gospels didn't, or there are reasons why those very specific claims wouldn't have been made in the earlier Gospels and so on?
Well, I think the oddity of the situation of the Gospels is that we have three that are remarkably similar. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's something which perhaps as Christians we're sort of used to, and so we think that's a perfectly normal thing, but it's actually an extraordinary thing in ancient history. You don't have very many cases like that, this, where you have one biographer of whoever it is, Alexander the Great, starting things off, and then two modeling their biographies on Alexander the Great in very, very similar ways. So it's not so much that it's sort of three against one in the case of the Gospels, but that there's a synoptic tradition about Jesus and there's a Johannine tradition about Jesus. And neither the synoptic tradition nor the Johannine tradition, I think most people would agree, it's a truism to say that they don't preserve the actual words of Jesus, because Jesus didn't teach in Greek. But again, I don't think it's necessarily the case that the synoptic evangelists are the ones who preserve the real historical Jesus,
right.
and the Johannine Jesus is something way off. That,
right.
The synoptic Jesus is an interpreted Jesus, just as the Johannine Jesus is an interpreted Jesus.
Yeah, sure.
So, yes, can I respond to that?
Yeah.
I mean, I agree that it's not a simple thing, but it is remarkable that you get these synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, alike in so many ways. The reason they're alike is because they're copying similar sources. And so Matthew and Luke were probably both copying Mark, but Matthew also had his own sources and Luke had his own sources. And I think that probably they had something called Q, which was a source available to both Matthew and Luke that contained many of the sayings of Jesus. I think Matthew had a group of other sources that we call M, and Luke had a different group of sources we call L. Mm-hmm. So I think behind the Synoptic Gospels, you've got at least four strands of tradition, Mark, Q, M, and L. And in none of them does Jesus make these divine claims.
Well, but Simon's saying he does make claims
Jesus
of
does
divinity,
not,
but not the very same ones that
it's
are
It's not just
in
the same ones. Jesus never explicitly says anything like, before Abraham was, I am, or I and the Father are one. He never explicitly claims to have pre-existed in glory with the Father.
Well, I mean, let's pick up this whole issue of pre-existence, because, I mean, this is another issue that you raise, is that... So two of the accounts of the synoptics, Matthew and Luke, have the birth narrative, the idea of a virgin birth and so on. Now, I think your take on that, Bart, is that, well, that doesn't give you a pre-existent Jesus. That shows that there were some traditions going around where Jesus, as it were, was divine at the point of birth. And that's the kind of
I think unless you impose the Gospel of John on Matthew and Luke, if you refuse to impose John on Matthew and Luke, you don't have the idea that Jesus became incarnate through the Virgin Mary. John has the idea of an incarnation. Matthew and Luke have a view of the virgin birth. It's only when you smash those together that you come up with incarnate through the Virgin Mary. If you read Matthew and Luke, there is nothing, in my opinion, in the birth narratives to suggest that Jesus was a pre-existent being who now has become born of a virgin. When he's born of a virgin is when he comes into existence.
So in that sense, what you think they're affirming is what I think the technical term might be an adoptionist view of deity.
Well, it's a little bit tricky because when Jesus is born of a virgin, it's not that he's being adopted. He's not a being who's being adopted to be God. He's God. He's the Son of God because God is literally his Father. It's the Spirit who impregnates Mary, so that the Father is actually God rather than Joseph. And so it's not actually an adoptionist view. It's a view of somebody who's born to the union of a divine being and a mortal.
Now, I think you sort of come back on this in your book, don't you, to some extent, Simon?
Yes, a little bit. I mean, the main place actually where I addressed this was in a book I wrote quite a while ago, back in 2006, which I called The Pre-Existent Son. I think the subtitle is Recovering the Christologies of Matthew, Mark and Luke. And I think I would agree with Bart to the extent that one needs to disentangle the questions of virgin birth and pre-existence, and they're not sort of necessarily the same. It's not that pre-existence must entail virgin birth, and virgin birth must entail pre-existence. That they're sort of separate. They're distinct theological themes. But I do think that again that this is one place where what one has implicitly or rather what one has explicitly in John's gospel is already there implicitly in the synoptics as well, where, as Bart said, you got very explicit statements of pre-existence in John's gospel, the glory which I had with the Father before the foundation of the world. But again, I wouldn't see such a radical disjunction with the synoptics there, because in the book that I wrote on this, I argued the case that in the numerous, I think there are 10 or so statements in the synoptic gospels across all the different sources, you have these "I have come" sayings. Where
I have not come to abolish the law, but to fulfil it.
Yeah, I have come to cast fire on the earth, which I think is actually one of the most striking ones. Where some, of course, have explained this as a way of saying, you know, this is what I'm here to do,
right.
Just as you know, my life's work is to do such and such. But actually, there aren't any sort of nice parallels which might lead you to understand the "I have come" sayings in that way. By far, the closest parallels to all these statements are the statements where, in the Old Testament and in Jewish literature from the time, angels say, "I have come in order to do such and such. This is what I have come in order to do on earth in this either short or long stretch of time in which I'm on earth." That Jesus in the "I have come" statements, when he says "I have come in order to do such and such," is summing up his earthly ministry.
And that suggests that he's come from another place, another realm.
That's right.
The spiritual realm, let's say.
Yeah.
And so this is an implicit reference to the idea that Jesus did pre-exist his human
absolutely
existence.
Yeah, and you can't understand those. You can't interpret those statements as you know, "I've come from Capernaum to Nazareth to cast fire on the earth,"
because that doesn't. There's no parallel for that kind of.
Well, yes, and it also wouldn't really do justice to the sweeping claims that he makes about his coming. That he hasn't come to do a little thing here and a little thing there. He's come to fulfill the law and the prophets.
Yeah,
he's come to
yeah
cast fire on the earth.
And these are quite sort of grand claims that are being
absolutely
made.
Yeah.
I saw you were just diving for your Greek and New Testament there, Bart, so you must mean business at this point.
Now I get down to it.
Well, okay, go on then. What were you looking up there?
Well, I mean, no, Simon has a really interesting argument, and he's arguing against the grain of scholarship.
Oh, sure, okay.
So this is Simon's view, not the general scholarship on this one.
But I think it is an interesting claim. My view is that the "I have come" statements are not statements about where Jesus originated, but they're statements about why he's here. This is why I'm here. It's not answering where were you before. It's answering what are you doing here.
Oh, sure, yeah.
And I think it's parallel to what is said in the Gospel of John. It's not exactly the same grammatical form, but it's the same basic idea in John chapter 1 about John the Baptist. He was sent by God, and he came in order to bear witness to the light. Well, following Simon's logic, you'd have to say, well, where did he come from to bear witness to the light? And God sent him from where? And so, well, then John the Baptist probably pre-existed. But nobody wants to say that. So I don't think that these statements about "I have come" are really trying to say anything about Jesus' pre-existence. They're really trying to say what his mission is.
Any response there?
I would certainly agree with Bart that they're not introduced into the Gospels in order to make a point about pre-existence. Absolutely, they're not sort of answering a question, where did Jesus come from? But as is the case with a lot of the stuff that we do when we're trying to work out the theology of the Gospels, or the theology of Paul, or whatever it is, we work out the theology about topic X.
Sure.
Sometimes when the author is talking about topic Y and isn't interested in making that particular point. So I would agree that again it's implied rather than explicit.
I mean, when it comes to sometimes in people talk about there being a sort of a line in Judaism, and you can kind of tell whether people are talking about something that's divine or something that's human. And the question is, did Jesus' sayings in general and the way people reacted to him put him on the divine side of the line or the human side of the line, if you like. Now, from what you said, Bart, you think that actually that the Gospels are making claims about his divinity, but not as full-bodied in the sense as the Council of Nicaea, for instance, you know, it would eventually put it down. But you do believe he was still on the, as it were, divine side of the ledger.
Bart doesn't think there's a line. That's
oh, okay. No, there is. There are all sorts of lines. what I think is, whenever somebody says Jesus is God, you have to ask, in what sense is he God? And that question makes all the difference. Mark understands Jesus to be God in a different sense from Luke. And Luke understands it in a different sense from Paul. And Paul understands it in a different sense from John. And so you have to engage in careful analysis to figure out in what sense do they mean that.
Draw out the Mark-Luke difference then. What's your point of view on that?
Well, Mark's gospel begins with Jesus as an adult. Mm-hmm. And the first thing that happens to him is he gets baptized and he hears then a voice from heaven, you are my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased. This is the first indication in Mark that Jesus is the Son of God, and I take this as an indication that at this point, God has made Jesus his son.
So you think Mark is saying then that's the point at which Jesus becomes the Son of God?
Yeah.
So he doesn't have it at the virgin birth.
Because he doesn't have a virgin birth.
He doesn't have it pre-existent.
He doesn't have either a virgin birth or a statement about pre-existence. So that what's happening in Mark is Mark is following the widely held view that you have in Greek sources, Roman sources, Jewish sources, that there are some people who are adopted by God to be his son. In all of these sources, what happens is the person is made a divine being by God adopting them. I don't consider this, by the way...
So this is what I referenced earlier, the adoptionist position.
This would be an adoptionist position, yeah. but one should understand that in the Roman world, to adopt somebody as your son was a huge thing. Mm. It meant that your son had all of your own prestige and power and wealth, so that if Jesus is adopted to be God's son, it's unbelievable.
Still a fantastic claim.
It's an unbelievable claim. This person has become the heir of the sole heir of God. This is a fantastic claim. Mm. For Mark, it happens when Jesus is baptized, in my opinion. In Luke, it happens when Jesus is born. His father is literally God. The Spirit gets Mary pregnant.
Okay. Do you follow this at all, Simon, or do you think that?
No, I think that's totally wrong about Mark. I have to say. I
mean,
I think
tell
it's
us
just,
why.
I think it's just a speculation to say that the voice from heaven at the baptism implies that Jesus becomes son. Then, I mean, the voice from heaven, "You are my son. In you, I'm well pleased." There's no indication there that this is creating a status of son. Just as, I mean, jump forward eight chapters to the Transfiguration. Again, there, the voice from heaven, the voice from God says, "This is my son." Again, there's no indication that, you know, if I could put it crudely, that he's sort of readopted the Transfiguration. That these are two declarations from God in heaven stating what is the case.
I think I think the difference is that I see this for one thing, the voice of the Transfiguration is speaking in the third person. This is my son. It's not making a declaration to Jesus. I think that the voice of the baptism is alluding to the ceremony that happened when kings became the king of Israel, when they are declared to be the Son of God. It's at that moment that they are, at the coronation ceremony, that they become the Son of God. Going back to the promise of God to David in 2 Samuel, that his son will be the Son of God.
Mm. But if that's the case, then your other point is that it was actually the resurrection that enabled Christians to start talking about Jesus, God's son.
Yes,
but here you're saying, no, it's actually at the baptism
no.
of Jesus.
No, so what I'm saying is that the original followers of Jesus, the men who were following around and some of the women, when they came to believe in the resurrection soon after Jesus' death, they thought God had exalted Jesus to be the Son of God at the resurrection. God has now elevated Jesus. And what happened is, as they thought more and more about it, some of them came to think, you know, he must have been the Son of God, not just when he was raised from the... He must have been the Son of God for his entire ministry. and there developed stories that at the baptism, God adopted Jesus to be the Son. And as the other Christians started thinking more and more about it, they thought, you know, it wasn't just his entire ministry. His entire life, he was the Son of God. And so then they came up with stories about Jesus being born of a virgin, so that he's literally the Son of God at his birth. They thought more about it, and some of them started saying, he's the Son of God from eternity past.
So this is the sort of evolutionary story that's being painted then. Mm-hmm. Just before we go to a quick break, quick response, Simon.
I think one of the appealing factors about that kind of story is that it's a neat and tidy story where you get, you know, Jesus is first of all adopted at the resurrection, then, you know, his it goes backwards and forwards. I don't think, unfortunately, the chronology of the New Testament writing sort of really bears that out, because of course if you look at Paul, which is the early, you know, Paul's letters are the earliest writings in the New Testament before Matthew and Mark and Luke, you've already got a very
high Christology
there.
Yeah, and so we're going to come to that more specifically next week.
In my opinion, sort of, you know, puts a bomb in the middle of nice, neat evolutionary story.
Yeah, it only puts a bomb in it if you have a nice, neat evolutionary story, which I don't have.
Okay.
I don't think that it's a strict chronological progression.
Okay. We'll take that break, and we'll come back just for final thoughts on this. And we're going to have round two, of course, as well. But what did you think today? What do you make of both my guests' points of view? Be interested to hear your responses. As ever, you can email in unbelievable@premier.org.uk. And do make sure to check out the links to both the books that I've been mentioning on today's programme, How Jesus Became God and How God Became Jesus. They're all available from the show webpage, where you can find today's programme and lots of past programmes and resources too. That's premier.org.uk/unbelievable. We'll be back in a moment's time, concluding today's discussion and flagging up what we'll be doing in the next one.
You're listening to Unbelievable on Premier Christian Radio.
So concluding today's discussion, the first of two, on whether the early Christians turned a human preacher from Galilee, a.k.a. Jesus, into the Son of God. Bart Ehrman and Simon Gathercole, I'm so glad to say, are going to be joining me again next week, because there's a whole other sort of discussion to be had about what Paul and other writers in the New Testament made of the person of Jesus. And it sort of was just hinted at there in that last discussion you were having there, Simon, with Bart, in regards to the high Christology of those very earliest sources we have kind of puts a bomb in the evolutionary story. Well, we'll come back to that. But overall, we've been kind of more tackling Jesus as represented in the Gospels today. And I think you're prepared to admit with Bart that, yes, views on the divinity of Christ do change over time, in the sense that you get sort of a more clearly defined, and people work mm-hmm. out some of the issues and so on about how would that work and so on, mm-hmm. till you get to something as defined as the Council of Nicaea in mm-hmm. 325 AD and so on. But that's not the same as saying, for instance, the church made it up, basically. I mean, some of your biggest fans, Bart, let's be honest, are Muslim apologists. I think you're probably aware of this, and they love
I'm aware of it, but not guilty of it.
Because, you know, that you're saying things that are great in terms of a Muslim response to Christianity, where obviously Jesus is still revered as a prophet, but they don't want, obviously, Jesus to be revered as God. And so in that sense, I've often heard Muslims say, yes, they came up with the idea of Jesus' divinity at Nicaea, basically. Mm-hmm. You know, before Nicaea, you didn't have any of this. Now, I'll let you respond to that. But what's your view on that kind of idea of this progression?
Simon? No one, I don't think, denies that there's development in the early church about how Jesus is understood. So of course, you know, two of the main categories that become used in Trinitarian discussion are essence and person. You know, the idea that God is one essence but three persons, but of course no one would claim that, you know, this terminology and the precise working out of it in systematic terms is already something achieved in the New Testament. But the early church is seeking to understand how the various witnesses of the New Testament can combine. As I mentioned earlier, I do think that the Nicene formulation is a natural outgrowth of the seeds that are already there in the New Testament. The seeds where, as we mentioned, particularly in John's Gospel, you have the tension between the claims that I and the Father are one, on the one hand, you know, the same essence, to put it crudely, but also the Father is greater than I am, that they're a distinct person. But I suppose where Bart and I would disagree is that I see much the same tension in the Synoptic Gospels as well. That in the Synoptics already you have the same seeds. Jesus claimed that he has the authority to forgive sins, and a divine prerogative in the Old Testament, but that he does this amazing, you know, miraculously, by virtue of being Son of Man on earth.
Would it be fair to say, this is just my untutored thoughts on this, but that in a sense that was such a massive claim, a theological bombshell in, you know, monotheistic Judaism, the claim that Jesus was God, that it would have taken a while for people to get their heads around that kind of a claim, and you're not going to see immediately people saying, or Jesus sort of saying, I am God, I am equal with the Father, and that it's perhaps unsurprising that, if you like, it takes a bit of time for people to say that's really what he was saying.
Yes, that's right. I think both in the Synoptic Gospels and, admittedly, to a lesser extent in John, it's implied, and it requires a lot of figuring out. You know, in all the Gospels, the disciples spend a lot of time confused, and you know, you can understand
about the identity of this person they're following.
Who is this? Who is this person? Who is this that can claims to forgive sins? Who is this that even
has
the winds
power?
Of,
yeah. See, yeah.
So a lot of the time, the Gospels portray the disciples as just not getting it, and I think that's partly because it's not because Jesus didn't say, didn't make exalted claims, but because he did make both exalted, very exalted claims, but also very lowly claims. The Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. I mean, you've got that at the other end of the Christological spectrum, you know, a very low sounding Christology.
But final thoughts as we start to wrap up today's show.
I mean, I agree that you get the same tension in the Synoptics because the authors of the Synoptics think Jesus is God. The question is, in what sense do they think that Jesus is God? When the disciples are confused about Jesus, the gospel writer never says, because Jesus was calling himself God and they didn't know what to make of that. They didn't understand his claims to be the Messiah or the Son of God, which are very different from saying that he's a pre-existent divine being who was with the Father in the beginning and shared his glory. It's a very different understanding there. Let me just clarify one other thing. I do not think that Christians made up the idea that Jesus was God. In other words, there's nothing cynical about it. Mm-hmm. It's not that they decided they wanted a new religion, and so let's make somebody into a divine being. They had an experience of the resurrection. They believed that Jesus had been raised from the dead. And on the basis of that belief, they naturally concluded that Jesus has been made a divine being. And they began worshiping him right away. The Synoptic Gospels are writing decades after this. They have this belief. So they do understand that Jesus is God, but they don't understand that he's God in the way that people today think that Jesus is God.
We're going to come back to this. We've had a storming first part to this discussion, and we've got a treat because Simon and Bart both coming back next week to continue this discussion. Hope you can be with us too. Do come back when we continue to unpack the thesis of Bart in his latest book, How Jesus Became God, that this was not, as it were, the way Jesus thought about himself or his earliest followers did. And we're going to be kind of focusing next time, gents, on what's sometimes called the early high Christology, you know, that we find, as I said, in Paul and other places. And is that a marker that the first Christians really did believe Jesus was co-equal with the Father and so on? I'm sure there'll be much more to discuss at the same time next week. So I hope you can come back too. And as ever, if you want to get in touch, I do encourage you to email in or drop me your lines or your thoughts via the Facebook and Twitter. I'll give out those details in just a moment's time, and we'll hear some of your feedback to the last few weeks of programming as well. What a variety of shows we've had over the last month or so. So look forward to reading some of that out. In the meantime, I'll say au revoir to Bart and Simon, and look forward to having you both back same time next week.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Unbelievable with Justin Brierley.